Hello, I'm Paul Richards with the latest from science. And with the testing for COVID-19 now being ramped up across Australia, we think it's worth taking a closer look at the tests themselves. How reliable are they? And who should be tested? Academy Fellow Professor Carola Vinuesa is co-director of the Centre for Personalised Immunology at the Australian National University. Carola, welcome.
Hi, Paul. How are you?
Very well, thanks. Is Australia testing enough people at the moment?
Look, it still varies a little bit from state to state, but generally most states are testing everyone that has come back from overseas or from travel and has had symptoms within 14 days of their trip. Then also everyone that has had symptoms and has been a contact of a positive confirmed case within in the 14 days prior to the onset of illness. Also healthcare workers with symptoms and staff in residential care or aged care facilities with symptoms. Now, there is some states that have increased their testing criteria. So as of this week, for example, New South Wales is also testing in centres or areas where there have been outbreaks of community transmission. And, you know, in different states, testing has also increased to, for example, those that self-identify as Aboriginal, those that have been referred by general practitioners and have symptoms, those that are living at high-risk settings and have symptoms, and this includes, for example, detention centres, military barracks, etc. In some cases, for example, in Canberra, they are doing some random sampling of people that don't fully meet the criteria but turn up in testing clinics and have symptoms. But still, there is not a very widespread testing of all of those with symptoms.
So I suppose as more tests become available, that rate of testing might increase. Can you tell me a bit about the different kinds of tests that are currently available and what are we using?
So look, there are two basic types of tests. One is what we call the PCR test. This is the one where we use a swab to sample viral particles that are in the back of the throat or the back of the nose. And this is a very sensitive assay. It detects viral nucleic acid or RNA. It typically detects it early within the first few days of someone developing symptoms. And it's very sensitive and specific. The only problem is that as people recover from the disease and the viral particles are no longer there, then one cannot use this test to know if a person has been infected. Now, the second type of test is what we generally call a serology test. This is a test performed on blood, or typically finger prick blood, and it mainly detects the antibody response against the virus. So this antibody response can tell us that somebody had a previous infection. So it typically commences within 7 to 12 days of the onset of symptoms. And so while it has no role for diagnosing acute infection, it can be quite useful to know if someone has had a previous infection with this coronavirus.
That's really interesting and a really clear sort of definition of the different roles those tests play. Another form of testing that is being discussed is that of feces. As disgusting as that might sound, it actually apparently can provide another way of testing. Can you tell us what we know about that kind of testing and what role it might play?
Well, look, yes, there is increasing evidence that the viral particles can be found in feces. Potentially, they might be detected earlier than the nasopharyngeal swabs become positive. And there is some evidence that perhaps they might also linger for a bit longer in feces compared to these other throat swabs. Having said that, it's still unclear whether these viral particles detected in feces are infectious. So I think more work needs to be done.
A test like that, could it potentially be carried out on a community sewage system, for instance, to help monitor maybe hotspots of infection? Would that be practical?
Yes, and I think, there are several studies that are proposing exactly that, not just to monitor, but also to detect potentially areas where there is community transmission that haven't been picked up because symptoms can be mild or, as you know, people can be asymptomatic.
What about healthcare workers? Are they undergoing regular testing now?
Look, they are not, and that is an area of major concern, really, because there is a couple of issues that particularly affect healthcare workers. One is that, as we know, they are going to be more exposed than the average person. And we have learned from the international experience that, for example, in Italy, up to 20% of infected people are healthcare workers. But not just they might be infected more readily. There is some evidence that in some cases, they might develop more serious disease. And there is some speculation as to why this might be. It might be that they are exposed to higher doses of the virus. And of course, the consequences of infecting healthcare workers really have an impact on how we manage the epidemic. And for example, infected healthcare workers can more easily transmit disease to patients in hospitals. And remember that in many cases, infections are asymptomatic or disease can be transmitted in the pre-symptomatic phase. So these healthy doctors with no apparent symptoms could be transmitting disease to precisely the people that could suffer more severely from complications of COVID-19. And also, of course, infection of healthcare workers would reduce the number of healthcare workers available in the workforce. So it is the opinion of quite a few people, including myself, that we should be testing widely healthcare workers, particularly those in direct contact with patients, regardless of whether they have symptoms, regularly, ideally, let's say, for example, once a week.
Yeah, that seems to make a lot of sense. Now, if we were to test all symptomatic people, what symptoms should be included of people? What sort of symptoms are displayed? Even though you said that sometimes people aren't even showing symptoms when they are carrying the disease, but what is the criteria there?
Well, precisely because of this issue that you've just raised, I think it's important to be quite liberal and to just learn from the experience of what has been published to date on the most typical symptoms. And look, it looks as if, fever is a relatively consistent symptom, but not just fever. Some people present without fever and with symptoms of a respiratory tract infection, and this could be cough or shortness of breath or a sore throat, for example. But then there's also an intriguing set of new symptoms that are now being increasingly associated with COVID-19 disease. And these include, for example, the loss of smell. We call that anosmia. I think there is now evidence that, 30 to 60% of all infected cases do lose sense of smell. And there are a few tests being developed to be able to monitor these, but also sense of taste. Acute loss of sense of taste is associated with COVID-19. So presumably either of these symptoms in isolation could be sufficient to prompt a test.
Now, another of the Academy's fellows, Professor Helene Marsh, has emailed in. She's asked, should we be doing epidemiological testing for COVID-19 at hotspots like Bondi, she suggested, as one location? What is epidemiological testing and how should that be designed?
Right. So, look, testing in general in an epidemic serves two functions. One is to diagnose and identify cases that will require monitoring and immediate isolation and contact tracing. The other one is what we call surveillance, which is to be sure that we are not missing areas of local transmission due to strict testing criteria. So I think it is clear that we will find cases where we look for them. And at the moment, criteria have been relatively restringent, just focused on return travelers and their contacts. But as we see the cases decline, there is the risk that there could be a small but increasing number of cases that are due to local transmission. Now, to be able to detect those promptly, we need to do some type of sentinel testing or sampling populations. I mean, we could randomly choose suburbs and test everyone in those suburbs. Now, that's not very practical in that we don't yet have unlimited testing capacity. But a way to do that is to choose some suburbs to start with, potentially those where we already know there is community transmission, and then test everyone that comes in, at least everyone that comes in with symptoms. So in that way, we have a way to identify transmission chains and through, again, contact tracing and isolation of infected cases, we can quickly break those transmission chains.
So, Carola, why would a location like Bondi be good for this kind of testing?
To answer that question, Bondi is in the Waverley Council, and that's the number one hotspot, the area that has had the largest number of infected cases in New South Wales, and it has now been designated as one of those areas where anyone with symptoms can be tested. So I think those recommendations are now being made public.
Now, Nina Harwood has written into us on Facebook and said that she's read online that some of the test kits coming from China are faulty. Who makes the tests used in Australia, and what's your reaction to those sorts of comments?
Yeah, look, there has been some reports. Spain was notorious in importing millions of these point-of-care serology tests that proved to be not very sensitive at all. And it is true they came from China, and it is true that in Australia today, I just had a look before we started, and 17 of 19 TGA-approved serology tests come from China, with the other two coming from the US. And the problem is not necessarily where they are being manufactured. The University of Oxford has recently tested a vast array of these type of serology tests and concluded that they are generally not very sensitive. So only 50 to 70% of real positive cases get picked up. Again, this comes down to the technology. I don't necessarily think it's a problem that China is facing. I think it's going to be that, you know, there is limited sensitivity with these pregnancy kit-like tests. And we still think that perhaps the way to go might be through doing these more conventional antibody tests using ELISA in laboratories. But time will tell. I think we need to test more, and the technology will obviously improve as the days go by.
And I guess it's important to keep in mind that this is a virus that experts are responding to as it's happening, as it's spreading, and we're working as quickly as we can to improve the quality of that testing. But we haven't got the luxury of time here, and that's just the nature of conducting, unfortunately, a live experiment in developing and improving the tests we have available.
Exactly. Exactly where we are at the moment.
Yeah. Now, is there any evidence that someone can be infected by COVID-19 more than once?
Normally, we think that once a person develops antibodies, those antibodies tend to be protective. And this probably will be true for COVID-19, as it's been for most related viruses. We know there are exceptions. But it is true that recently we have heard, for example, from South Korea, a number of patients. Initially, it was 50. Now, I think it's gone above 90. Patients that, you know, at some point tested negative and then they tested positive again. Now, we don't yet know what the real cause for this is and whether they really were reinfected as opposed to having a chronic infection that they didn't clear up properly. And as we've discussed, sampling different tissues and sources in the body can give different results. We just talked about feces versus throat swab. So it is possible, and I would like to think that that's going to be the explanation, that these patients might have had more chronic infection, they might have not completely cleared the virus. And we do know that there are examples of patients in which infections can be more chronic. It could be related to their immune system, to the severity of the infection they had. And we know even in other animals and mammals, even in bats, there are cases reported of more chronic coronavirus infections. So I would like to hope that there is going to be immunity, but definitely it's early days and more research has to be done to confirm that.
Okay. Another related question, are there different variants of COVID-19 that we're aware of?
Look, like all viruses, COVID-19 is mutating very rapidly and it's evolving. And that evolution is very useful because we can help create trees and understand where each focus is coming from and how viruses are related to each other. Now, there is not very good evidence yet that those mutations are of physiological relevance, that they are really changing the function of the virus or making it more virulent. They are occurring in parts of the genome that do not really have an impact for protein function. So I think at the moment we don't have reason to believe that we should be worried about the rate of mutation or the nature of the mutations. But of course, time will tell and this could change.
Okay. What about the impact of winter? Do we know whether or not there is a greater risk of the spread and severity of COVID-19 with winter on our doorstep?
Look, again, it is too early for this particular virus to know for sure. But we can first draw lessons from other common coronaviruses that cause the common cold, and also other viruses like influenza that cause respiratory tract infections, in which clearly there are seasonal patterns and peaks occur in winter. Now, in terms of this outbreak, there has been already a number of studies. We have to be cautious because none of them have yet been peer-reviewed. But even though there's some conflicting evidence from the different studies, most point to the fact that, yes, probably it is those areas that are colder, perhaps in between the 5 and 11 Celsius degrees, that could be a better environment for this virus to spread, and also areas of low humidity. So tropical areas might be less conducive for the virus to be transmitted. Having said that, that impact might be relatively small, the impact of climate compared to containment measures and in a situation where, you know, there is no immunity in the population against the virus. It might be that even in seasons where the virus would otherwise not spread so much, it will still spread. So I think we should expect perhaps a little bit more transmission over the winter, but other measures will be more important than climate to really contain the virus.
Okay, that's really interesting. Now, just finally, what's your outlook for Australia? When do you think authorities will begin to ease restrictions?
Look, that's a very good question that we don't yet have answers for, but it's clear that Australia has managed to flatten the curve, and this is really good news for our healthcare system. We are not overwhelming our intensive care units, but it does mean that probably, you know, the disease will spread over a longer period of time, and we might have to really be here for the long haul, trying to keep these numbers low and potentially maintaining a level of social distancing until there is a vaccine.
Carola, thank you very much for your time.
Not at all. Thank you, Paul.
And a reminder that if you're looking for videos and articles about COVID-19, you can visit a special area of our website. You can find it at science.org.au/COVID-19. And if you have questions for our experts, feel free to leave a message underneath this post. I'm Paul Richards. See you soon.